static content, right?
Yes.
Say it again, please.
How do web server decide when to serve the static content and when to serve from the when and when to serve from the dynamic content?
Yeah, I will tell you that. Okay, just give me 2 minutes. Let me just finish that.
Okay.
I will tell you that because I have to show you the plugin CSV file for that. So we understand this, right? This concept, the overall concept of how it all works, it all connects, right? Any questions?
I'm good.
Okay. So I've given some description about IHS, dynamically shared object, which we have discussed about it, multi-processing modules, and then web server installation. So you know the IHS installation, it's very simple with GUI. You just go to the installation manager through that. You just navigate to the path and install that.
Okay.
You have any questions on this CLI mode as well?
No,
so these are very important folders.
Okay.
So when you talk about any software in Unix, bin folder
okay.
is part of it. Conf folder is part of it. Logs folders and modules folder. Sometimes you will get a folder called lib folder as well. Depends
yes.
on the application. So if it is a Java, you will get a lib folder. If it's an application
okay.
which is designed by C, C++, you will get a modules folder. But both
oh,
are the
okay.
same.
Okay.
Okay. They are just to you know integrate with multiple other stuff. Right.
Okay.
So that's how it is. And htdocs is basically the default document root of your HTTP server. So
okay.
in all HTTP servers. Yeah, yeah. The location where it contains is static pages.
Okay.
We call it web apps in Tomcat. We call
okay.
it install application in WebSphere. We call it stage
okay.
in WebLogic. So the name differs, but then the purpose of it is the same, where you store the content. Okay, so this is the web server configuration. This is like the modules, like multi-processing modules configurations, the worker processor module configuration. It just tells you like a number of amount of threads you can hold, the maximum threads you can hold at a point of time, and every process will have how many threads to it. So basically that kind of information it would be saying. All right. So I've just given you an introduction to this, so you just can you know understand it from there. Or it's like, you know, mostly you don't need it because everything will be configured already. Nowadays, what we do is like we add to the existing things. We don't create new things. But
okay.
then it's pretty much simple. It's nothing you know, rocket science here. So this is the virtual host configuration. We already discussed about it, but then I'll just go
yes.
through this because
yep.
this is something which we need to create a website. So, oh crap, I opened WebLogic. Oh crap. So what we do normally here in the web server configuration is that we just go through the virtual host, name virtual host. Name virtual host is defined for a name based virtual hosting. There are three types of virtual host available. One is like the IP based, name based, and the port number based virtual host. IP based means virtual host concept itself is like you know hosting multiple websites on a single instance of HTTP server. That's why we call it virtual host.
Okay.
When you talk about the virtual host thing, virtual host has three different configurations for these three different type of virtual host. So IP based means you need to give IP address every time you define this tag called virtual host, wherein which it listens on a specific IP address. The website will be listening on an IP address, so it's completely dependent on the IP address. And name based virtual host is nothing but having a single IP address or all the IP address to listen on multiple website name. So basically it checks for the server name configuration. If the server names are different, then obviously it's going to go to that server name irrespective of the IP address. For that, this is required. If this is not there, the name based virtual host will not work, and if it's not there, it will think it is an IP based virtual hosting. The moment you're gonna define the same thing again here, if this is not there, it will go for this one only, for the first one only, because it never goes for the second one, because it doesn't know that it has to classify based on the server name.
Okay.
So here, if you do it like this, it will check for the server name here, and it will find a match with the URL. If the match is found, then it will load this content from here. If the match is not found, then it will go to the next virtual host entry, if it's available.
Okay. When it goes for only the first one,
you said?
Again? No, if something doesn't match, you said only to process the first one only, you said, right?
That first is virtual. Like, if you don't give name virtual host, right? And if you're giving multiple virtual hosts like these, you're configuring multiple virtual hosts like these, and it will always go for the first one because you have defined star over here.
Yeah, okay.
For everything, it will go over here, irrespective of the server name. Because it doesn't understand the server name, because you didn't tell it to search for the server name here. You just asked to search for the IP address, so.
So, IP based, it will accept so only from one server, because coming from only one machine, right?
If there is no unique IP address defined for every website, if it is like defined, if two virtual hosts is defined, right, and it has a unique IP address, here there is a different IP address and there is a different IP address.
Achha.
So it will,
it's like static IP,
so it will go routed to that IP address and it will check in the virtual host for the IP address if it matches the IP address. This, the match will be different, that's it. I mean, if it's IP based, it will try to match the IP address. If it's a name based, it will try to match the server name. If it's port number based, it will try to match the port number.
So here, our example is it's port based, right? Yeah. Name based.
This is name virtual host. Man, wherever you see name virtual host, it's name based.
Okay, but can we say this port based? How will be this port based virtual host?
It's simple. Just a second. Okay, so name based means this is mandatory.
Okay,
so here I'm just changing a few details. Yeah, so this is name based. Now how it checks is like it checks for the server name. Server name is matching or not. Okay, if I do the same thing for the Yeah, for this this one. Okay. Yeah. So it'll not check for this one. Reject for this one. It'll be like 192.168.1.2.
Okay. Instead of star, we specifically mention the IP. Okay.
So whenever a DNS routes to 2.1.2, it'll get this
okay.
one. And then a DNS routes to 1.3, it gets here. Okay. It basically checks
okay.
this one, then the other way around. That's
okay.
basically IP-based virtual hosting. Okay, port number based virtual hosting is similar to IP based virtual hosting.
Okay.
Except that. Okay. It will have the same exact configuration. Okay, so here it says 1.2, right? It is a 1.2, 1.88. Okay, it'll have the same website name,
yeah.
same alias name. So it will only check for this one.
Why we do this actually? Since it's already, if you got port number 80, right? Why we go for
8080 port? It depends on your client. I mean, their requirements. Sometimes what they want is like they want the same website name. But then they want for development, for production. So you can just tell them that, you know, 80 is production and 8080 is development. So you just type
okay.
www.iv.com and you go to production.
Okay.
If you type www.iv.com colon 8080, you will go to stage. So in this way, you don't have to have multiple DNS. You can have only one DNS, all right? That one DNS will route the request over here. But using the port number, using that DNS name, one DNS name itself, you can route it to different application levels.
Okay.
You getting it?
Yes.
So here you don't have to create multiple DNS. You don't have to create one for the dev.ivr.com, stage.ivr.com. You don't have to create that. You just type www.ivr.com and then
okay.
you type a port number to define which environment you want to go to. You want to go to 8080, then it's development. You want to go 8040, then it's stage. So like that, you can also configure it. It's like some option given to you. Either you take it or not, it's up to you.
So here the server alias will change in port based.
Come here.
Server alias element will be changed.
No, why it should change?
Because it has to route to different instance, right?
No. That's where this one here it will be the context route will change for sure. Like it will go to stage underscore stage. I didn't get that. So here it will change to stage again. Here it will take to underscore stage just to differentiate that, you know, we want a separate log for that from the production. So that's how we can make it. Yeah, so that's basically is the virtual host. Virtual host basically has three types, based on the IP address search, based on the name search, and based on the port number search. So these are three different types of search you can use towards identifying your virtual host. Whichever is best for your scenario, you can go with that. You got it right.
Yes. So this history docs on WebSphere is install docs.
Installed apps, yeah.
Installed apps.
Yeah.
Okay. So installed apps is not the deployed application. It's a static container.
Yeah.
I thought it's a completely application file.
Say it again. What did you say? Installed apps is?
Installed apps only. static content or complete the application? You said me that it's in the installed applications will be there, right? Installed apps.
Whatever you're installing, for example, if you're installing a var file, right? Installed apps will create a EAR file, and then it'll put the var file inside it. So WebSphere always does this, okay? And when you go for Tomcat or JBoss, right? So what it does is like, if you deploy a var file, it'll be, the content will be var file, even in WebLogic the same. But WebSphere, what it does is like, it creates a EAR file itself, and then puts the var file inside that. So what it does is like, if your var file doesn't have a context root, so at the time of installation itself, it will ask for the context root. So at the time of creating this EAR file folder, right? Sorry, it will create the static, sorry, it will create the application.xml, and it will put the context root there on the EAR file. It will not modify anything about your var file, but then it will create the context root at the EAR level. So it is applicable for all the var files that you have in there. So WebSphere works differently when you compare with other application servers in terms of deploying the application. Okay, so I'll just show you once it's up. It's, I don't know, it's taking too much time to start it up. Anyways, let's wait for it.
How does it happen in WebLogic? You don't just deploy it as var file?
If we deploy it as a var file, it goes to the stage folder and sits there as a var file. It gets extracted in the temp folder, right, for this one. So it works in a different method. And WebSphere, what it does is like, it tries to fill the gaps, and then it will create a EAR file every time you deploy a var file. So there'll be no, you know, just show you that. So if you just go over to, so you just go in there, and then you find, I mean, you deploy a var file, so you can see that it says like var file, right? But then it's a EAR file. Okay, it's not a file, it's a folder, but then it just creates EAR everywhere. So it's like application name.ear.ear. Okay, so basically what it does is like, everything has to be EAR for WebSphere. That's how it can process it. Okay, so calendar is a var file basically, but then it creates a EAR file folder. So if you see meta inf application.xml, you can see the context root which you have defined at the time of installation is part of this, because this context root is not available inside the var file, because normally it will be in web inf web.xml, but it didn't have that context root. It didn't have the context root. So if you see, this is the web.xml, there's nothing else. So when it created or when it installed the application, right, it just ask it from you, and then it writes it on the application.xml under the meta inf folder. So this is the work of WebSphere. Okay, most of our applications, what it does is like, if you put a JBoss here, or Tomcat here, right, what it's gonna do is like, the name of the application will be the context root of the application. Okay, so if it's a calendar 1.0 require, so you have to use the same same this as a context root for the application as well. Okay, but WebSphere, you know, as it's a measured application server, so it normally, you know, gets to deploy everything as a EAR file, no matter what you want. You know, you get what this wants. Yeah, so that's how it works over here. And coming back to the HTTP configuration, we did the same thing. We went to IBM HTTP server, conf, http.conf. Alright, so in here we just go over to virtual host. Okay. So we just define a website over here. You can define multiple websites unless and until you have a document root for it. and a name to it. Okay, so basically name which loses for that, using a single IP address or a group of IP addresses in the same system, you can defer multiple websites. But all the DNS should point to the same IP address. For example, if I'm giving 1.2 here and I'm giving on all the virtuals, no matter IPA.com or LAC.com, should point to the same IP address. But then we don't worry about it because we have load balancer. We can configure however we like it. We have Amazon load balancers nowadays. What we do is like we just point the DNS to the Amazon load balancer, and under the Amazon load balancer, we add the instances. How many of our web server instances we would add it. And I'm also planning to give knowledge transfer, or sorry, this training on AWS, because nowadays the middleware administrator need to take care of the AWS as well.
Yeah,
that is one of the roles and responsibilities nowadays.
In our consulting,
implementing on AWS. Yeah, and it is pretty interesting to work on AWS. I'm planning to give for that as well, because we are looking SOA and all those things is not a big deal actually, because it is just one-time configuration again. When you want to deploy stuff to it, like the XML files or something like that, you just go to the console, click on the right thing, and click on that. Not a big deal, very specific BPML and all those things. So it's very easy. It's just a layer on top of WebLogic. SOA is nothing but if you want to have a MQ, separate MQ, or if you want to have multiple application routing, converting the data. So you just go for SOA. So you have many objects there. SOA suite has many things there. BPML. I just forgot. So there are many things there which you need to apply over WebLogic. Okay, when you do that, right, that's it, your work is done. You just have a individual URL to browse it, because the application service will generate a new URL for you, the port number, so you just have to browse it through that URL. And it's just a layer, as I said you before. And then you have just to deploy normal XML files on the top of that. That's it. But AWS is completely different from what we have seen till now. It's going to be completely managing instances, shutting down, taking a clone of it, backing up, all those things. It's quite interesting.
And for WebSphere, we have a message broker and queue and this stuff, right? For WebLogic, what are components?
Okay, everything comes with the default Java, okay? Yeah, so for example, if you go for any other application service, like Java-based application service, everything comes with the default JMS thing. Okay, but apart from the JMS thing, if you want to use any third-party MQ clients, why we use them, because sometimes they give you 100% deliverables. They will make sure that the message gets delivered no matter what. Okay, that's a promise they give. Okay, that's why we still use MQ services other than the normal ones. Keeping that in mind, our WebLogic has SOA component. So in SOA component, you have a specific MQ client for it. Okay. So it's like SOA we have for WebSphere, something called MQ. Okay. And in terms of JBoss, we have something called, there's one more called JBoss. It's called, I forgot the name of it. Not Rabbit MQ, it is, it's how is Edge. It's right on my mind. I'll just tell you when the day progresses, it will come back to me.
And WebLogic also, do you use only MQ?
WebLogic normally we will be using JMS. Yeah, JMS is pretty easy. You can make your application, manage server to be a JMS server itself.
Okay.
Okay, that's how JMS has been designed for. Your managed server will take care of the, you know, it will be the JMS master server, which takes care of the, you know, the connection between the requester and the sender, or publisher and the subscriber. Here in MQ, or if you use the SOA component, right, for messaging, so what happens is like there'll be a specific messaging server, okay, which does all these processing. So you will have an individual server for that. But when you don't have it, right, it's going to use the global one. It's going to use the complete one. Yeah.
And what is activation
Activation specification.
Yeah.
We'll talk about it. It comes in, you know, in terms of, you know, if you are defining some other component for external use. Yeah.
Okay. For external application server.
Yeah, it's not application server, but then if you're using external components to contact with the application server, so we use activation specification. Yeah. Now we'll just talk about it later, not this class. Yeah. So let's get on to this one. Yeah. So the first thing is that, or once you've done that, you can browse the IVR.com. IVR.com will only work in case if you have a DNS entry and your web server is running. So right now, the IVR.com is not working. Now, first, many websites, if it is not working, the first thing you would do is like to troubleshoot the issue, right? So first thing about troubleshooting is like, okay, simulating the problem. Okay, I just simulated the problem. I just typed IVR.com and I had the error. Now, there could be multiple reasons why it didn't work. Could be a network failure, could be a web server failure, or could be the load balancer failure to serve the content or anything like that. So first and foremost thing what we do is like we start from the scratch. We just use a normal basic command called ping IV.com. Okay, and then we see whether the ping is working. Sometimes if you are contacting the load balancer, the ping will not get a reply because ICMP is nothing but this one is disabled. The ping is disabled. But then what you will get is this one. You will get the IP address. You will get the, you know, saying that, okay, this belongs to this IP address. Or you can do NS lookup as well just to be sure whether your website is configured on the DNS or not. Hello. Okay, normally I get a reply pretty quick. I don't know what happened to this. Okay, so that will say the IP address of it. So that is to ensure that your website is being routed or not. So second thing is like, after the successful thing, which is you go to the login to all the web servers and see from the AWS console itself, there's a way to see whether the instance is available or not. Okay, if you have AWS console, just log into that, and there are specific things you need to select and to go to the load balancer. And then once you're in the load balancer, you can see the instance's status. So the status will tell you whether normally we can monitor an instance with different ways. Okay. You can monitor using TCP, you can monitor using a file, you know, the AWS load balancer will fetch a file and to check whether the application is running or not. There are different methods you can monitor server's availability. So we use one of these methods to identify the server's availability from the AWS console, okay? This is just to ensure that see if you have 10 different nodes under the load balancer, right? You cannot log into all the servers and check it out. Okay, so we just use this one console to just check it out, the instance's status. Once you configure the, once you understand the status of the instance, then you get inside that and check that path by PSFNEF grep of HTTP. So you can see that HTTP is not running, so it is quite down. So just go to OPT-IVR-HTTP server, then Apache CTL. So you can, what you can do is like before you do that, you can also check who shut it down by going to docs and then going to error log. Okay, so you can see that this is not being shut down, it is being killed because there is only a status of starting Okay, there's a
Okay.
status of starting, and you can see that code will not be returned for server crashes. So that is basically, it's just the information saying that it will not write code in terms of a server getting crashed. But that's fine, but the server was not crashed before. Okay, so here you can see that there is a seek term. Okay, it basically tells you that someone is asking it to shut down. Okay, so this way you can understand, okay, someone is asking you to shut down, so it is shut down. But here, no one asked you to shut down, so it would be because someone killed it. Okay, so you can see last to check who logged in, recently, and it is a reboot happen over here. So that could be the reason for us to, kill the process, because when a reboot happens, when the process is running, it's not called shutdown. Okay.
So crash in this is into application in this one. Web server itself crashed.
Yeah,
something like
it rarely happens, yes. But you know that, right? This time it didn't crash.
Yes.
Just restarted. Okay. I'm able to, whenever you get permission denied, it means one thing, you're not on the right user. I'm getting the website now. This means it is working. The next thing is plugin. Okay, so just go to configuration file. Don't guess the plugin location because it might change, depends on your system. So, two things we're gonna add in terms of plugin. The ISO file and the plugin. Okay, so you can do it automatedly. I've said you the way of doing it automatedly. But if you want to do it manually, it's very simple. You have to copy these two lines from an existing server and put it over here. And then you need to make sure this path is valid, because this is actually the name of your web server, and this path is valid. Okay. So this is going to be the same, it's going to be Apache 2.2 module, and this module file you can take it from the plugin location. So if you go to OPT IBM plugin, right, so in here you have, inside the bin folder, you will basically have the file inside 64-bit. You can have the SO file, so you can just copy it from this location and put it to your modules folder. Okay, so based on the version, if it's 64 or 32-bit. But anyways, this configure IHS plugin.sh will be doing that for you. You don't have to worry about that.
So,
okay.
It's already in that particular shared path, right?
Which?
Okay, in the initial stage, you are saying.
Which one? Yeah.
Shared object while creating.
While after installing the plugin, right? This folder gets created.
Okay.
Okay. In this folder, it will have the file already.
Okay.
Okay, so when you run this configure IHS plugin, right, it will copy it from this location. But when you don't want to do that, when you want to do it manually, you can just copy it from this location to that modules folder and get yourself over with that. Okay. I'm just telling you the location where you can find the SO file. Okay, this is a very important file. There are multiple files in this location. Okay. So you have logs, which has the log folder, okay. You have the config, which has the configuration of XML file, okay. If you open this file, you will have these two more files here.
That's okay.
Okay, these are basically the the key files which is used to communicate.
Yeah, sometimes what's happening is from HTTP server to another JVM,
connectivity will not be there. So what they do is like they normally add that particular, for example, if you've changed the certificate of that server,
yes.
Okay, so you need to add that public certificate to the certificate or else it will not work. There'll be no communication. Okay, normally this connects to that one. Okay, so whatever the certificate you are installing should be part of this one as well.
So using key to we have to add this again.
Normally it does it automatically. It automatically does the synchronization. Okay, you don't have to do that, but sometimes if it doesn't do that, then you have to do it manually.
Okay.
There'll be no communication between this and that. And on the logs, it will say that it's like it's not able to communicate through, but it's getting an it's getting a SSL exception. So that time you have to look through this.
Okay.
Check this file.
The stash file is password.
Wait one second. PT IBM, Bashir, Patient Server, Java, TRE, PIN. Huh? Say it again. You were saying?
Stash file is for storing the password.
Yeah, right. Is it a PKCS12 file?
Yes. No.
KDB file. Hope you have your HTTP server plugin config. File doesn't exist there. That's what I was thinking. There's no file here. IBM plugin config. See, it's here. WebAS is the password. So if you see signer certificate, it will have all the certificate in there. Okay, so that's how it accepts all those people. So your certificate needs to be part of it until unless it has been signed by VeriSign or someone who's here. If it is signed by these people, you don't have to add it.
Okay.
If it's signed by yourself, then you need to add the root certificate of your company over here. Do you get it?
Yes.
Okay. So if there is no sign, it's like a self-sign certificate, then you have to add the self-sign certificate here. Okay, the public certificate.
Okay.
But if it is signed by someone else, okay, for example, you work for CTS. So CTS itself has a root certificate. So you just talk to them, you get it signed by, create a chain by signing it from them, and then you add CTS root certificate over here, then that's enough for you. So whatever the application you're going to use with that certificate will be part of this one. Okay. Let's not worry about that. Let's go to the plugin.xml. Now let's see the important thing why we came here. The first thing about this is like the XML file, so version of XML and blah 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 is defined here. And also you have some of the important configurations over here. But this is not to be touched until you've been asked to, because it's something like, you know, it's something about DNS, something about, HTTP header size and all those things. So, I mean, it is always left to default. We don't touch anything on the configuration side over here. Okay, the second thing about this is the log location. Log location changes over here based on what you want. By default, it will be error. Error in the sense only when you get an error, the log files will be updated. Status is another type of log where it gets knows the status, like it, you will get all the error, non-error, status messages. And then here are some of the properties over here, how it has to treat different settings. Okay, there's nothing to do with us again, so it's something, you know, deeper inside the plugin file. Okay, the next thing is the location of the plugin, which we need to change. The OPD IBM plugins. Normally what happens is like previous to this version, previous to version 7, we had this plugin installed inside HTTP server folder. But after this, we are installing it outside the HTTP server. Okay, so normally if you see plugin is configured inside it. Okay, so either you have to copy the plugin inside it, or you have to configure outside the plugin. Now how you can do that is like plugin is basically generated by your application server. Okay, so you can just modify it over here just to tell it, you know, you don't, it's not, plugin is not inside it, it's outside. If you go to web server, you click on the web server name, you go to plugin properties. Now here you need to say the location of the plugin. If you see, the location of the plugin is inside the HTTP server. Okay, that's why it is all configuring inside everywhere. Okay, if you tell that in the previous world to configuring the plugin itself, like, you know, the web server itself, that it is outside the plugin, then it will put it outside the plugin. Do you get it? Okay, the first important configuration of the plugin is the virtual host. Without the virtual host, nothing will work. Okay, so there is this connectivity. You always have to think like this. Okay, the first guy who comes in is the web server, and through the web server, it goes to the plugin, and from the plugin, it goes to the application server. Okay, so these three connectivity has to be very much for certain. Okay, there should be no disturbance in these three connectivities. From web server finds out where it has to go through the XML file, and then it goes to that particular server. Okay, so this is the three connectivity. Plugin is far more important, web server is far more important, and application server is far more important. Now what is very important more than this is like the rules. The rule has to be set right. If the rules are wrong, then the routing will not happen. So basically it's just routing, right? So the rules has to be set right. The rules is that first thing is like the web spear has to know who is coming in, okay, and who is going out. All right, this thing you have to make sure the web spear is aware of. Okay, that's what the virtual host is coming into the picture. And virtual host internally will be routed to the application, and the application will be routed to the application server. So when the application server starts up, it starts listening on the virtual host, and it starts to listen on the application. Okay, so all these things has to, you know, have to have a synchronization between one of them. Okay, for example, here virtual host definition is very important. Why? Because here we're going to define how the connections are going to be incoming and how the connections are going to be like processed, by who it is processed, okay, and who should be running. So it all depends by the virtual host. Now if you see here, I've created two virtual hosts for just for our example. Okay, so both virtual hosts will be used or cannot be used at a point of time. It depends on how your requirement is. Okay, there'll be like, now many in my current environment, I have like 20 to 30 virtual hosts. Okay, But if you ask me, all these virtual hosts that have been used, yes, they are. Okay, not 20 of them, but then at least 15 of them. It depends on your application. Okay, so what happens is like mine is a very big EAR file. Now, in this EAR file, there are multiple WAR files inside, like at least 300 to 400 WAR files inside that EAR file. So, if you see from the WebSphere console, if you just click on the application, right, you'll see only one application here. But when you, the moment you click on the one application EAR file and you go to manage modules, right, you will find hundreds of WAR files inside. Okay, so now why we create virtual hosts is like to isolate the configuration. That's basically we create multiple virtual hosts. For example, so here we have this bar file. Here we have another bar file. So for example, this is a jar file, this is a bar file. So, but think it's both are bar files. Or there'll be a jar file and a bar file, all right? So now these two things are there. Now, I want to have a different setting over here. I want to have a different setting over here. Is it possible? Yes, of course it's possible. So what I will do is like, I will create two different virtual settings for these. Okay. Okay. This will be like admin and this will be like host, developer.
Okay.
So what I do is like, I create a different virtual configuration for this and a different virtual configuration for this. And I will have a different application server to deal with this. Different application server to deal with this. Simple as that. Okay, so I have one application server, two application server, like we have two clusters over here. Okay, so I'm assigning this particular cluster and this particular web server over here, over on this one. Yeah, now you can see that it is applied on cluster 02 here, cluster 01 over here. So what I will do is like, I will create a different virtual host for this and a different virtual host for this. Getting it? So when I click on this application, right, I go to virtual host, and I get this one thing, right? If it is a multiple WAR files, right, you will get multiple things over here. You will get it only for one WAR file. So it's like, is the default web application. That's why I said it should be a WAR file. If it's another WAR file over here, right, this increment EJP module will be also there in the virtual host tab. If you see over here, the virtual host, you will have another entry for that. So hundreds of, for me, it will be like many entries, like 20 to 30 entries will be there. So I can assign individual virtual host for each of these. Do you get it? So what this exactly means is that whenever my application is being typed, whenever this WAR file is being called upon, now every WAR file will have a method of calling, okay? Method of calling is nothing but the context root, okay? For example, this one, default web application, right? So if you go to view deployment descriptor, you will have different context root. Here, see, snoop, hello, hit count. These are the context which is used for this application. When you want to browse this application, this WAR file, you use this context root. Okay, if you want to browse the other application, this WAR file, you use the context root which is defined inside here. As this is not a WAR file, I don't think you will find any context root here. Okay, so but if it is a WAR file, you will find in the context root over here. So when you want to browse this one, you need to browse that context root of that. So that's what we're going to say in the virtual host entry. Virtual host entry is just to isolate the different things. Okay, for example, here you have two virtual hosts. This is the default virtual host. This is the demo host virtual host. Okay, now you can see one thing is common in both of these, 80 port number. 80 port number is mandatory. If there is an incoming connection from an HTTP server, then you need to define an 80 port number or whatever. So if it's an ODR, an ODR has a different port number. So you have to specify that port number, without which the web server will not connect with the application server. That is mandatory. Okay, so 80 port number is mandatory first thing, because that's how the incoming connections are going to be, all right? The next thing is the actual port number of the application server. For example, if this is for the one WAR file and this is for another WAR file, so I've assigned cluster 1 to that WAR file and cluster 2 to this WAR file, right? So cluster 2, how many of our servers are there? That many port numbers has to be defined here, both HTTP and HTTPS. So you can see that 9080, 9443, 9084, and 9447. Now if you see here, it is different port numbers over here. So it's like 9080, 8080, 8081, 9081. So these are not part of this one, right? So because it is routing to a different application, this is routing to a different application. Internally, it all works on WebSphere, but then when it routes the request, right, it can route it to different stuff.
Okay.
Do you get it?
So yes. So each port is a different application.
Yep. Yeah, of course. Each port is different application server. Okay, but then they sometimes, you know, two application servers can work for one application.
Yeah.
Okay, so if you see these port numbers are working for one application, these are working for one application. Okay, so inside that application itself, there are multiple WAR files, right? So
yeah.
Yeah. So these are working for one WAR file. These are working for another WAR file. Okay. Now, how do you identify that? You just quickly go to the application server, go to application name, click on the name of the application, and go to manage modules, and you can see which one it is. Okay, how many applications are there. Now you want to find the virtual host, go back and go to virtual host here. When you go to virtual host, you can find out this application is routed to default host. You get it?
Yes.
If you go to application server and you click on the application name, and you get the port numbers over here. So you can see that it is configured 9081 and the SSL port number for this is 9444. Okay, now you go to the virtual host and you see the default host, host alias, and you see that one, 9081 is part of this one. So that's why we have assigned it. But then what you can do is like you can change it. You can change this particular EAR file. For example, manage modules, you can just change it to this one. We have changed it to cluster 2, right? Just change it again to cluster 2. So I've changed it to cluster 2. Now the 9081 will not work here because cluster 2 is this one, right? Cluster 2's port number is 9080. Okay, this virtual host should be defined with 9080. You can easily check it over here. 9080 is part of this one. Okay, so it will work because 9080 is part of it. But if I remove this entry, okay, I will not remove it here. You should not actually edit this file, but then in emergency you can do that. It's not that you know, but it's not recommended to edit the file. So 9080. So if I'm just going to remove that from the virtual host entry from default host, host alias, so 9080. All these changes which I do will be immediately saved to this one. Okay, but
okay,
not to the plugin file.
Yeah.
It will not be saved to plugin file. It will be saved only in the DMGR. Okay, so I've changed it. Now, who has this one? It's the demo host. Demo host has this entry, 9080 entry, right? So when you want to browse this, it should browse from the demo host. So you just go to the application, virtual host,
okay,
and change it to demo host. So I'm just changing it in the virtual host entry as well. So that my WAR file is pointing to cluster 2. Okay, and my cluster 2 is pointing to the cluster 2 port number is allowed in demo. Okay, and that same port number is allowed, I mean the same virtual host configuration is allowed in the application as well. So if you go to virtual host, you can see demo host. Okay, now let's compare let's see this one, what it says. Okay, and then basically we will just do another plugin and we will see the difference there. So now it's all configured on cluster 1. Okay,
yes.
Everything is
yes.
configured on cluster 1, and you have two virtual hosts here. One is default host and the one is demo host. Just kind of remember that. Okay, here The tag starts from server cluster. If you have an individual server or group of servers, it doesn't matter. It will always start from server cluster. Okay? So WebSphere creates a cluster, even if you have only one application server, right? So it will still create the server cluster, and it will make that one server part of the cluster. Okay, if you add another server, it will add that server to this one. Okay, so here are some details about the clustering, like, sorry, what kind of a cluster it is, what load balancing it does, okay, what are the name of the cluster, okay, some of the values, like, what is the interval, retry interval, so if it fails, how much time, okay, it retries to connect to the cluster members, what is the input output time retry, so minus one means like unlimited, so that's what it is, okay. Every cluster member will begin with something called clone ID. Okay, clone ID will be unique ID. Okay, this is how we can use to track the session management or to see the
So
cluster.
this is for each server.
Yeah, each server on the
Clone
cluster member
ID.
will have a clone ID.
Okay.
Okay, so this is how we can identify when the plugin log it won't say like server one, server two, and all those things. It will say the clone ID. Okay, so you just have to compare the clone ID into this one. It will have a unique name to it. So you have some values like connection timeout, load balancer value. So you can see that's a different load balancing value here, 213. So it means a round robin, but when you have these two different values, it becomes weighted average method. Okay. Some of the details like the name of the server. Name of the server will be like huge. It's because like it combines the node name and the server name. Do you get it? That's why it's pretty huge. It puts up the node name and the server name. Here you can see the node name and the server name. Do you get it? And this is a key file to contact when it's HTTPS request. And this is the port number of the server. Port number of the second server. Okay, the server one, server two. Now, in this configuration, when you come down, you can see primary server members. These are the two server members of the cluster 1. And this is the cluster 02 configuration. And these are the port numbers of these two server. And server name is servers 3 and server 4.
So again, why this port number is repeated?
Which
what
port number? This is for cluster 1.
Okay.
This is for cluster 2. So there is this two servers in the cluster 1, right? 0102.
Yes.
And there is this 3 and 4 in the part of the second cluster. And the port numbers for the 4, port numbers for the 3, and this is port numbers for the 2, and this is port numbers for the 1. The why two port numbers? Because HTTP, HTTPS.
Previously
we
discussed, right?
Yeah,
or
it's not needed.
After propagating, every time we have to modify
it? No, nothing like that. It will automatically get modified. You just have to copy it to this location. That's it. I'll tell you how to copy it to this location. As we are not using the default location, right? So you need to do a manual copy. Or probably it will automatically copy. I just don't know. Just we will have to, just propagate it and see what happens. Okay, so every time the clone ID will be different. So if you see clone ID is different over here, this is for different for this one, different for this one. Okay.
I have a small doubt.
Yeah.
What's doing in our office? We integrated J integrated with this HTTP server.
Yeah.
Okay. They wanted this clone ID. Okay, so then they can target to each specific JVM.
Yeah.
You got it right. Okay, but here problem is one of the environments they didn't configure this plugin.
Mm-hmm.
One of the training environment they did not configure this plugin. They
mm-hmm.
disabled the plugin completely, but the application is working fine. So how do I need to target a specific JVM on the application through web server?
First, let me complete this. Probably then you can answer it yourself. Yeah, it's something related to this only. Okay.
They said some reverse proxy.
Who?
when I asked the onshore people, they said, you know, training environment is configured in a reverse proxy rather than this IHS plugin.
Is it reverse proxy or proxy pass?
I'm not sure on that. I thought of asking you actually.
Yeah,
is
there are different methods you can route a request. So there are different methods we can route a request. Okay, so one is like proxy pass. So in JBoss, in Tomcat previously, we were using something called proxy pass. Okay, what it does is like it, you if you if someone hits a URL in a, you know, if it's someone URL hits a URL called yahoo.com/abc. So what we do is like we go to the yahoo.com web server and then do a proxy pass of /abc to a particular IP and a port number. So what it does is like it routes the request from here to that server. Okay, so if it's like only one server, right, there is no point of creating plugin file. So what we do is like we just write proxy pass space, you know, the one, and proxy reverse proxy is also one of the command we use for that. So we just give that and give the actual ABC and then the URL. Okay, so in that way, you know, it routes because plugin is automatic and autonomous. Okay, so there is no issue in writing a plugin, or you know, it's just generating a plugin.
Okay.
But proxy pass is more simple.
So if I have 4 JVMs, so how can I give this JIntegrity team to know target?
No,
because what I'm
no,
doing is I'm
you have to go for plugins. It's always recommended to go for plugins.
Okay.
If it's a cluster, even if it's a single server, it is always good to go for plugins. But then as they are saying that it is for temporary reason or something like that, they want you to, you know, write a proxy or reverse proxy. So that is something you can also do.
So they said reverse proxy and we have 4 JVMs on the server actually. So I have to provide these 4 JVMs. I mean, like they have to hit these 4 JVMs individually. So
individually. For different applications, all the same application.
All the same applications. This JIntegrity is nothing but the Selenium scripts will be run to test.
Is it WebSphere or not?
Yeah, WebSphere.
Then you can do a plugin, right? Why are you doing proxy pass?
Which one, sir? Which one?
You should be doing plugins. You should not do reverse proxy.
Plugin.
Yeah, you should be doing plugin if it's 4 servers.
Yeah, I'm not sure actually, it's configured long back, so but it doesn't have plugin because I saw that.
Just send me the configuration file, I'll be able to tell you.
What configuration? HTTP to conf.
Yep, yep. Yep.
But how to target one specific JVM through reverse proxy?
I will just give you the URL. You send me the file, I will just see if your guys have done it already, or else I will give you from my environment. We have so many reverse proxies there.
I'll try to grab if possible.
I just take a screenshot and send it to me, that's enough.
Yeah.
I don't want the exact file.
Okay.
Okay, so here, that's the first thing. Okay, so we have given this cluster name, okay, and we have 2 cluster names. So we have defined all the things over here. So it's done. Server cluster is closed now. Okay, the next thing is the third important thing. Okay, first important thing is virtual host. Second important thing is the actual cluster information. And third and the last important thing is URA configuration.
Okay,
URAs are very important because that's the thing which unites the cluster name, virtual host, and the context root. Do you get it? So here it says like the default underscore host. And then the cluster name. Okay, so it says like whenever this cluster members are called, and this is for this particular host virtual host entry, and this is the context root. Okay, now why it says is because now by default my application is routed to this default host and it is managed by this cluster. Okay, and it is managed for this context root. Calendar, same way. You can see that the calendar is pointed to cluster O2 and it is in the demo host. Okay, but now I've changed a bit, right? I will go to the calendar application and I'll change it reverse. Okay, I will go to the calendar application. Okay, I will just change the virtual host to the default host. I'm doing the other way around. I'm going to manage module and routing it to cluster 1 and web server. So it is in cluster 2, I change it to cluster 1. So I'm doing like, you know, upside down. So all I have to do is like first go and save the configuration. Synchronize the configuration, go to the web server, generate plugin, propagate plugin. So this should be copied to this location. So if I reopen this file again, so it's updated on 7/16/7/16. So when I open this file again, I will see the new changes. The new changes is pretty different. Okay, everything else is the same. Everything else is the same except the virtual host entry. Two entries are missing over here, which we removed it there. And then the cluster members are the same. There's no difference between the cluster members. See, two members of the cluster and two members in the cluster again. Okay, now it has changed a bit where here you can see, leave the sample application because we didn't change anything about the sample application. It's still the same, but we have changed everything about this one, Snoop, Hello, and all those things. It is starting to listen on demo, and we have changed on calendar as well. Calendar, we changed it to default host, prod cluster 2. Before it was 1, now it's 2. Okay, so this is what we have changed. Okay, so this is how we have to understand the request. So after every URI configuration, you will have the routing configuration, or it will say where it will route to. It will route to the same thing, cluster 2. Okay, so you can see that. And then host name, virtual host name is default underscore host. Okay,
okay.
So this is the three important things, and this is something like request filtering. Request filtering in the sense like you can disable people from the source IP address. Okay, you can disable from using this URI, Snoop and hit count. Why we disable is like this. These are like restricted URLs, so we kind of restrict it from people using it directly, and some of the web services. So something like, you know, request filtering basically filters all the requests. So
this,
right?
Configure
it
in the
VAS
console.
Huh? Yeah, everything.
So
here, everything needs to be configured. I mean, this file cannot be, it can be edited, but then it's not recommended to edit this file. Whatever you are doing, the way I showed you, modify it on the console and then generate propagate. That's it.
Okay.
After every 60 seconds, it will automatically get validated. I mean, it will refresh. This is refresh interval 60 seconds. So every 60 seconds, the new plugin file will be loaded. But remember, it cannot change the values over here. You expect these values to be changed. Okay, these server name values. And then after 60 seconds, you're expecting it to change. No, it will not happen. Okay. Sometimes a web server requires a restart. Like, for example, you are removing a cluster member.
Okay.
Okay. That requires a restart of your web server.
Okay,
they say that, everyone says that, oh, it doesn't require restart, you change anything in the plugin file because there's a refresh interval of 60 seconds, but it doesn't work like that. For certain things like, you know, removing the server client, because we do normally, you know, fiddle around the XML files manually. So that time, you know, it requires a restart. It won't, you know, reflect it without restart. So.
Okay.
Yeah, this all these things you will get to know when you have hands-on on things. When you actually work on in the environment and you face a lot of problems, you will get to know all these things. Yeah.
Interesting. Yeah.
So this is the.
So generally for which all those things we don't need to restart.
For modifying certain things like in the virtual host. Some of the one log levels, you change something in the log level and you leave it for 60 seconds, it gets okay. Yeah, the key file doesn't require like basically property level changes. Except that I think it all requires a restart.
Requires restart.
Yeah.
Okay.
What happens is like, see, there is a scenario where we wanted to, you know, there are hundreds of application servers under a cluster, okay, in our environment.
Okay.
So
okay.
What we do is like, sometimes we remove some servers from the cluster. Yeah, so if you want to create a beta website or anything like that, so we remove some servers and we put it in a different configuration file, and we route the other application server for the beta website. So what we do is like we manually remove it from here. We will not do it from the console because you cannot delete a member from a cluster. If you delete, it's permanent. Okay. So what we do is like the best thing we can do is like removing from the routing. We will not allow the routing to happen to those application servers. We will deploy an application to the entire cluster, but we will not let the request route to the entire application server. We just route the request. I mean, it's all about this, okay? When people don't access it, then it's kind of unused, right? So how can we stop people from accessing it? By not sending the request to it. That's how we can stop people from accessing it. One is like the people should know the URL to access it, right? They should know which context root to type. They cannot just type yahoo.com/something-something, right? Because they need to know. For example, I visit yahoo.com regularly for sports information. So I don't type, you know, yahoo.com and then click on sports, and I don't do that. Okay, I just type yahoo.com/sports, which means I'm getting redirected automatically to sports. And if I'm very interested in cricket, then I type yahoo.com/sports/cricket. Okay, so that context would exist, and I know that it is there. The client will not know about it when they don't know about it. So you either click on a link which goes there, or you just don't tell about them about it.
Yes.
Okay. Now, how can this happen is like, so for example, yahoo.com beta is coming. So they just name it as beta.yahoo.com. Okay. So that's going to be that. So whenever people route that beta.yahoo.com, they should go to the similar service like yahoo.com. Then that will be part of the yahoo.com cluster. But then the request will be routed to part of a cluster. Now, how can you route to part of a cluster when it's in a full cluster? It's basically the routing policy needs to be changed, and routing policy is all about plugin fncfg.xml. So you remove certain servers from here. For example, these two servers are serving yahoo.com. Now I want to route this server to for beta.yahoo.com. So what I do is like I remove this line from here. Okay, and save and quit the file. All right. Now, after 60 seconds, what's going to happen is like it's going to load this new configuration.
Okay.
But understand it. There are certain things which requires a restart. Okay.
Yes.
Now, this particular server is removed from here, right?
Okay.
Which means my application server, my web server will try to route the request to 02. Okay, because 02 is missing from here. It will try to first routed to 02 or 01 based on the load balancing mechanism. We give you round robin, right? So every time a new request comes in, the first request goes to 01, second request will try to go to 02, and then it will check the configuration here doesn't exist. Okay. And then it will say the configuration doesn't exist, the server is unavailable, I'm going to 01. So that kind of, you know, problem will happen when you remove it like this. So after a restart, it will not be aware that the server 02 is not part of the cluster.
At all.
It will not even route the request to server 2 because it's not sure.
Exactly.
As this is already loaded into the memory of Apache, it's not able to release from the memory. Do you get it? That's why we need a restart for certain things.
And how do we route this beta type thing?
So you just need to have another load balancer for beta. And just like, you know, you create another web server instance in the same thing. Okay, normally we don't disturb the production one. So we create another instance of web server. You know how to create an instance of web server. Okay, there's another instance of web server we create. Like, you know, you have this Yeah,
So
definitely a
on
prop
the
of HTTP,
server,
right?
we
So
can create any number of HTTP instances, right?
yeah, we can create n number of HTTP instances. Like this, you can create another set of this HTTP instances. It's like n number. It basically depends on your port numbers. That's it. You just need to configure a different port number. That's it. So, I mean, we don't care about the port numbers because we've been routed from a load balancer. So as this is routing, so you can put it on any port number. Okay, so basically you just need to configure the load balancer to route it on a port number. And then, I mean, load balancer configuration I'll teach you on AWS. It's part of that. So once you put that on, right, so AWS will route the request with that port numbers which you have configured. So basically you are like king. You don't have to do anything else. You just have to, you know, route basically. So, and then it just routes to the web server, and from web server it goes to the application server. Okay, so how it does it, like, we will have a create another configuration file. So I just did that. I'm really lazy, so I just took two copies of this. One is for the existing one, one is for the new one. So I just, like, you know, removed a cluster, and whatever the cluster I removed from the existing environment, I put it on the new environment for beta, and that was running with a new server. So basically when it routes a request to the different one, it routes the request to the new cluster, I mean the one which is separated, and that cluster will go actually to the beta. Other things will be working normally because we're not changing anything, except we removed a part of the cluster which requires a restart. We did a down, we took a downtime and we restarted the web servers, which came up really fine. So the beta was a success. Yeah, so this is like using the existing environment without adding any servers, without adding any application servers. Using the existing instance, we were able to accomplish the existing servers and as well as the new beta servers. So this is how it needs to be done. Yeah, so any questions for me?
No. Today's class is awesome.
Oh, that's good. So just do the practice and get back to me if you have any questions. Yeah, see you.
Thanks a lot.
No, that's not a problem. Bye. How to shut the video.